Much is customary to say thank you for that generous introduction. And I do really appreciate my brother the invitation to come to the Malefiketi Malefi Asante Institute. It is really my sincere pleasure. Anytime you at home and invited to share your work, it gives you an opportunity to really develop what you're thinking. And so today, I'm going to speak to the topic my dear brother assigned to me. He does that too. He gives you a topic to talk about. So I'm going to speak to that topic, but I'm also sharing with you my thinking in progress. So we're starting a little late with technical difficulties, and I may end abruptly if I find myself going on too long, but I had a presentation pretty much well developed, and then something happened, and I had to go back and kind of rethink what I was doing. And what happened is that I talked to some educators this week who shared with me some of the really critical issues that they were dealing with. And I'll say a little bit about that. And that gives me an opportunity to tell you that this is a presentation in progress. It's not something that I put together and finalized, but I'm inviting you to think with me.
Awesome.
And something that I also do when I'm working is I go to the elders to ask for their input or to help me make sure that I'm on the right track. And I will share with you also some input that I received from two of the elders that I talked to. So I'm going to share my screen and just get started. And we'll see how far we can go with the time that we have. Start up the PowerPoint. And I use PowerPoint because I know I can sort of just get off track and talk too long. So, and my cousin Charlotte is on, and she had told me last time, "Hey, you need to give more time to the slides." So I'm afraid I'm not going to be able to give more time to the slides because we don't have that much time. So just try to keep up, y'all. So let me move this off the screen. Okay, so the topic, memory and myth in the African context, and I added a subtitle from the Nile to the Niger to our neighborhoods, because for me, the African context is not just continental, but it is also here where we are. So I will be sharing with you work that I've been doing across these contexts. The Nile in terms of Kemet, the Niger in terms of Songhai, and our own diaspora context. Okay. So if we started with the Nile Valley civilizations, Dr. Finch was recently sharing some information online, and I just captured an exchange that he had with someone. So Dr. Charles Finch says there are so many points of comparison between ancient Greek and Egyptian culture that most of Greek culture can be seen to have derived from the older Egyptian. This is something that many of us still don't understand. And Dr. Finch says this is a truth that the Greeks themselves never denied, especially not Herodotus. We can start this comparison by examining the Greek Zeus on the one hand, and the Egyptian Amon on the other. Each was the supreme deity in his respective mythic paradigm. We're talking about myth now. Each possessed control of the forces of heaven, for example, thunder and lightning. In fact, the Roman form of Zeus, Jupiter, was called Jupiter Amon. One of the meanings of Amon was so be it, which came down through the Romans as amen or amen in Christianity. Dr. Finch continues, and the spirit animal of both Amon and Zeus was the ram. Again, Herodotus was categorical in his assertion that Greek high culture, such as it was, descended from the Egyptian. So I'm going to also be sharing with you some of the examples of the scholarship or what the books tell us about some of these issues. And here you have an image of Martin Bernal's Black Athena back in 1987. He jumped into the discussion about the sources of ancient Kemet, and his book is titled Black Athena: The Afro-Asiatic Roots of Classical Civilization. Main point of all of this, we do not start our story with slavery. And this is a lesson I learned from Baba Asa Hilliard and John Henry Clark. And it means also that we need to pay attention to any story that we're engaging with. Where does it start? So, also just a reminder that we're about to come to the close of the United Nations International Decade of People of African Descent. And Dr. Asante opened today's lecture talking about Ma'at and African human values. So we do not start our story with slavery, but rather with our humanity. Again, memory and myth in the African context from the Nile to the Niger. So I'm going to switch now to some comments and observations about the Songhai civilization in the Niger River Valley. Right now, today, there are events happening in Mali that I want you to know about. And you see here this image of, it's a photograph I took when I was in Egypt with Asante in the Nubian Museum. These are not live pictures. These are models. But I tell you, when I looked at these models in the museum in Kemet, I immediately saw Songhai. And the Songhai people say that their origins are in the region that we now call Kemet. And I can tell you that what these models are weaving is exactly like what you would see right now today in any Songhai community. So we're talking about memory in the Songhai community today after 12 years of violent occupation. It's unfortunate that because of the language barriers, a lot of the news that comes out in French is not accessible to us. But the Songhai community in Mali has been under 12 years of violent occupation. And they decided to respond to this reality by remembering and invigorating their traditional values. And so on the 6th of March, Dr. Hassimi Maiga was enthroned with the title of Chief of the Songhai Community of Gao, and you see him in the center wearing the double turban, black and white. That might remind some people of the two crowns of Egypt. And this image of another chief riding a horse shows that the Songhai people are not just in Mali, they're in different countries. And for this ceremony, chiefs came from Asango and Burim in Mali, but more than 1,000 people, they say thousands of people, were gathered for this ceremony on the 6th of March. So, myth making is also about amputated memory, how our memory gets cut off as a result of these myths. So we have this image of Mansa Musa. I'm going to say a little bit about Mansa Musa because that has to do with some work that I've been recently doing with one of my graduate students, an article that we published. But also, just a little observation, the 1619 Project book, Born on the Water, is a little bit of a distortion. We were not born on the water. Our story does not start with slavery. There is a lot of buzz about a new book that's just come out, Born in Blackness. And this book has on the cover Mansa Musa again. Some of you may know that Mansa Musa was a very, very significant emperor in Mali in the 1300s. You have Ghana, Mali, and then Songhai. So the book is celebrated as revealing the central yet intentionally obliterated role of Africa in the creation of modernity, born in blackness, vitally reframed our understanding of world history. Well, my doctoral student and I were invited to submit an article for a journal, and we worked on it. And what we decided to write about was all of the buzz about Mansa Musa. I mean, if you go on YouTube, there are all these videos about Mansa Musa, but they give a limited, amputated, distorted view of who Mansa Musa really was. And we were surprised when we got into the book Born in Blackness to see how this particular author treats Mansa Musa. In comparison with other historical accounts, Born in Blackness, which is written by an African American professor of journalism, very prominent, who frequently cites the work of Michael Gomez, presents a rather unfavorable interpretation of Mansa Musa, less favorable than what the historians have to say. As I said, the book jacket hails this book as revisionist, brilliant reworking of the conventional wisdom. But curiously, this is what he has to say about Mansa Musa, regarding Mansa Musa's famous pilgrimage to Mecca. That's where you see him with the gold nugget on the cover. So this author says that Mansa Musa craved recognition as an equal, and his grandiose ambitions undermine Mali's image. Another pernicious consequence of the trip, that is his pilgrimage, and not one to be underestimated, is the way Mansa Musa's extravagant use of slaves, which was every bit as eye-catching as his flaunting of gold, may have reinforced sub-Saharan Africa's reputation as an inexhaustible source of black bondsmen. Now, this is an interesting kind of blaming Mansa Musa for slavery. What? But yet the book is being hailed as, the best thing since sliced bread, which means we have to be very careful when we're reading scholarship and listening to what is being offered to us as a new interpretation or a new story. So that's one of the things that we observe in the article that will be published soon. Moving on, memory and myth from the Nile to the Niger. We're leaving the Niger now, the classical civilizations of the Niger River Valley, to our neighborhoods. And as I said, the African context includes us in the diaspora. So I'm still talking about myth making. And we have a lot of myth making in the social sciences, in the research, and in the academic disciplines. And I remember something Walter Rodney wrote about. He said how disconcerting it was to find that the very sources you go to do your work basically talk bad about you. So here we have two books from the 1940s that certainly served as a foundation for the kind of education that I received in sociology, The Myth of the Negro Past. So we have Melvin Herskovitz coming out with a kind of, it's not really true that the Africans lost everything. They still have some African that's a part of their heritage. Well, this was news in 1948. And The American Dilemma, subtitled The Negro Problem and Modern Democracy. This is written by Gunnar Myrdal, foundational text for the disciplines in the social sciences. Well, when Myrdal's book came out, Ralph Ellison, you all probably recognize the name Ralph Ellison, our celebrated writer, Ralph Ellison jumped in to say, hold up. This book is not everything that is being made out to be. And he critiqued Murdahl's argument that the American dilemma was all about Americans' moral problem. And he said, no, it's not about that. It's about our humanity. And why do you have to come and argue at this point in time that we are humans? So we have had this ongoing debate with these myths for generations. And when it comes to our humanity, I love this analysis, this example of John Brown's colleague Dangerfield Newby, 1859. This is definitely not the way that slavery is taught in the textbooks. Dangerfield Newby's wife, Harriet, wrote him a letter. Dear husband, I want you to buy me as soon as possible, for if you do not get me, somebody else will. The servants are very disagreeable. They do all that they can to set my mistress against me. Dear husband, you are not the trouble I see these last 2 years. It has been like a troubled dream to me. It is said that the master is in want of money. If so, I know not what time he may sell me. Then all my bright hopes of the future are blasted. For there's been one bright hope to cheer me in all my troubles. That is to be with you. For if I thought I should never see you on this earth, life would have no charm for me. Do all you can for me, which I have no doubt you will. I want to see you so much. The children are well. The baby cannot walk yet. The baby can step around anything by holding on to it, very much like Agnes. I must bring my letter to close, as I have no news to write. You must write soon and say when you think you could come. And we know Dangerfield Newby gave his life in the struggle against enslavement. But this is evidence of the humanity that characterized our experience in this inhumane system. So myth making is all about falsifying, just telling lies, and fallacy, mistaken beliefs and faulty reasoning. And this is what we've experienced in our own education, which Carter G. Woodson calls our miseducation. So the falsification and ethnocentric bias in my field of education research includes pathologizing the language and culture of poor Black children. That's from an article that appeared in 2009. It hasn't stopped. And then the fallacy, telling lies, calling Black children super predators. This happened back in 1995 with an article or an analysis that talked about the coming of super predators. This is myth making in our area. So this notion of super predators leads to harsh, racially biased sentencing. State laws were passed mandating automatic adult prosecution for children, life sentences without parole or death, children housed within adult prison with adult prisoners. So this is not Ma'at, as Dr. Asante said. And in 2001, going from 1995 to 2001, the US Surgeon General finally labeled the super predator theory as a myth, but the damage had been done. So now I want to talk a little bit about memory. And the example I want to use is Africatown, Mobile, Alabama, another African context or African diaspora context. And it has to do with the last Africans who were brought on a slave ship from Dahomey. So, Sylvain Diouf's book, The Dreams of Africa in Alabama, came out. After that, Zora Neale Hurston's book was discovered, a book that she had written about the last cargo. And this Africatown community exists today, the descendants of these Africans who were kidnapped and brought from Dahomey. So the most recent book about Africatown is called The Last Slave Ship, the true story of how Clotilda was found, her descendants, and an extraordinary reckoning. Well, I was so pleased to get this book and start reading it. And then, my goodness, the description of Dahomey was frightening and terrible. I couldn't quite grasp, is this really true? Is this depiction of the African reality all there is? Barbarous tribes, human sacrifice, female Amazons. And it reminded me of a question my granddaughter asked me the other day. Who captured slaves in Africa? Well, there's an answer for that. Are we able to explain that in a way that even young children can understand? Is that even the right question? Sylvia Winter reminds us there were no Africans then, because what our children are often exposed to, children and teachers, is the idea Africans were selling Africans. Asante has reminded us who traveled to Africa in search of captives, who created an entire industry of shipbuilding, insurance, outfitting of crews and ships, and banking based on the slave trade, who benefited enormously from the evil and vile project of human kidnapping. I'm going to try to speed up a little bit to finish. And a professor Odete of the University of Ghana says it's the gun which was a deciding factor in the slave trade introduced by Europe. This is my point. Where do we start the story? Yes, Dahomey had a vital role as a major participant in the slave business. But what happened to Dahomey? How did it get to be like that? It's not just something inherent in the African condition. The former president of France said, "We bled Africa 4.5 centuries. We looted their raw materials. Then we told lies that the Africans are good for nothing. In the name of religion, we destroyed their culture. And after being made rich at their expense, we now steal their brains through miseducation and propaganda to prevent them from enacting black retribution against us. We need Black studies curricula to implement the Afrocentric paradigm and liberate school knowledge from such myth-making." And you can see some of this myth-making, the before, the after, and the way after understanding of this religious perspective. So, to go a little faster here, I wrote an article in 1992, based upon my experience in the textbook fight in California, diaspora literacy and consciousness in the struggle against miseducation in the Black community. And this quote here from Professor Degler was the orientation that we were dealing with. He says, if you talk about the slave trade, you have to point out that the slaves came over to the New World primarily because Africans enslaved them first or captured them in war and sold them to the Europeans. They weren't picked up by Europeans in the depths of Africa. They were brought by Africans, and you have to say that, and that the whites were there, of course, that traded for them and brought them here and found them extremely useful. Well, this is only partly true. As Sylvia Winter has pointed out, the African peoples at that time didn't see themselves as one people. So it's not correct to say Africans were selling their own people into slavery. When I did this work on the Curriculum Commission, I also did a study with parents and teachers, and we were talking about the distortions in the textbooks. And one of the parents said, "This shows that they are not ready to deal with a total change in the culture. And here are all these kids riding around with guns, and it's the white kids too." So right now we have gun violence and street crime on the way up. Way up in Atlanta, Baltimore, Chicago, Detroit, Philadelphia, Oakland, New Orleans, where else? What is going on and why? So as I started to prepare this presentation, I had to stop and think about what is the value of this knowledge if we can't connect to what is happening in our communities, to our children, with our educators and parents. There are perverse economic incentives involved in this violence. Earning $1,000 a week in the underground economy can be more appealing than a job making $15 an hour. Community-based violence prevention programs aren't designed to upend harsh economic realities. More than a third of the homicide victims in Baltimore in 2019 were between the ages of 16 and 25. So I'm challenging myself to think about how can the knowledge that we are producing be of service, saving the lives and providing for a way of living in Ma'at for our young people. So there's a program in Baltimore called Baltimore Ceasefire 365 that estimated, and this particular article that I read estimated the impact of a recurring community-led ceasefire on gun violence. And I'm gonna close in just a couple more slides. So I contacted the elders. I contacted Baba Jeremiah Wright and Queen Mother Joanne Watson in Detroit, and I asked them, "Can you give me any examples of what the community has done in the face of this crisis that we're experiencing?" And they said to me, Baba Jeremiah Wright said, "I would start with the response to the Tulsa massacre and describe how the African American community worked together in response to the violence rained down on them by white supremacy. John Hope Franklin's father set up a temporary office in a tent among the rubble to draw up lawsuits against the racists for the loss and destruction of Black-owned property. He worked pro bono nonstop for 2 weeks in Tulsa to give the Black citizens hope and a phoenix-like sense of victory over the hatred that caused the massacre. I would also then move to description and discussion of the Deacons of Defense as another example of victory over violence in the Black community. Before concluding with an explanation as to how white racism causes violence among Blacks in the community, I would definitely have to talk about what the middle-class Black community and the white community never wants to talk about publicly, and that is the Black Panthers and the Nation of Islam, and how their presence and teachings give countless examples of victory over violence in our communities." And then Queen Mother Joanne, Reverend Joanne Watson in Detroit went on to say, "I'm certain that no community can claim complete victory over violence during these times, but I strongly believe it is important that we recognize and applaud examples of resistance and overcoming that have transformed and empowered our communities." And then she talks about the fact that in cities like Detroit that are heavily populated by fast food franchises that far outnumber grocery stores, this is a form of violence against the citizens that are manifesting epidemic levels of obesity, high blood pressure, hypertension, diabetes, and other chronic diseases, which catalyze early preventable deaths. So the news we get about the very serious problem of gun violence and street crime, we have to have in mind these other forms of systemic violence. And secondly, the example she gives is access to water as a human right, and Detroit residents have been forced to overpay for municipal water even though they own the water system, which services millions of residents outside Detroit. For generations, Detroit citizens have been charged retail rates for water, while suburban citizens who are customers, not owners, are charged wholesale rates for water, about two-thirds less per household. And I remember Reverend Watson talking about what happens to families when the water is cut off. They have even lost their children as a result. So these are just two examples of community coalition building in Detroit addressing these kinds of problems. So I'm going to bring this presentation to a close, and I want to say that we need to reconnect and remember what is happening on the African continent today. And here you have pictures of three young soldiers who are generals and interim presidents leading transition governments after coups in Mali, Burkina Faso, and Guinea because they are fighting terrorist violence in their countries. And these young leaders are all being opposed by France, the U.S., Ivory Coast, Ghana, and Nigeria because the charge is that they are anti-democratic. Well, the young people in these African countries are supporting their transition government leaders, and this is what they have to say. So I'm going to try to stop before I had some other things, but I'm not going to go that long because I do want us to have a chance to talk. We need to challenge America's myths. I've talked about myth making in the African context, and there's been no American president who is not engaged in wars and murders outside of the U.S. borders. And five of them who are now alive had their bloody hands involved in wars in the countries mentioned below. Countries not listed in this graphic include some of the African countries. We need to think about Haiti. So myth making works both sides, the ways in which our memory is amputated about who we are and what our government has been doing in our name. So I'm going to stop there and see if Dr. Asante wants to take a few questions or comments.
Wow, Asante Sana, Dr. King, can you hear me clearly?
Yes.
Thank you for that amazing presentation. Thank you so much. At this time, we will open it up for questions. I can take about two. I see one in the chat from Dr. Sakai that says, will you be sharing the PowerPoint?
I will be happy to.
Wonderful. Thank you. Do I have any other questions that just were not put in the chat from the audience? You can unmute yourself at this time if you have a question. Okay. If there are no questions, I'm going to call up Dr. Asante to close us out. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Joyce King. Really appreciate you very much for this wonderful presentation. And it